I hope I brought my digital pen. I want to do drawing, but I don't think I brought my digital pen. Nothing. Sorry for the slight delay, guys. Okay, I forgot my digital pen, even though I'm supposed to do digital drawings. That is such good news. Okay, never mind. I'm gonna try to continue the lesson without the digital pen. Okay, boleh. Okay. Okay, are you all ready? Are you all okay? Okay, saya minta maaf atas delay tadi, ada masalah sini sana. But I hope that you are able to follow me for this lesson now. So let us begin with the overview for male reproductive system. So I know this is the part that you were excited for. I told you I will draw. So we are going to draw. Not nice from that angle. We are going to draw a man and his reproductive system. So we start with the head and then his shoulder. His head, neck, shoulder. Only gonna draw the important parts. Ta-da! This is a man's reproductive system. Okay, belum lengkap lah, of course. So if we're talking about male reproductive system, of course, you know that the important parts are inside. You have the two testes. The two testes, and they have the epididymis. Epididymis, which is ancam ada saluran yang di luar dia, where the spermatozoa are going to travel through after they are mature. And this connects to a vas deferens that connects up. And then up here, you will have the seminal vesicles. Seminal vesicles, which means this is the little organ that will produce the white nutrition stuff that is known as semen. Okay, and then you also have the prostate gland. I forgot what is the function of the prostate gland exactly. And then basically the vas deferens akan bercampur dengan isi kandungan daripada seminal vesicle dan dia akan bersambung dengan ureter, the same tube that came from the urethra, the same tube that came from the bladder. Saya ingat pula dia punya anu ni. And that goes out through the penis. Okay, so most important thing for you to remember here, of course, you will know this thing. This is a penis. And then this is a testis. Kulit yang melindungi testis adalah scrotum. This is your vas deferens. This one is epididymis. D-I-D-Y-M-I-S. Epididymis. Okay, so these are the organs that you can see on the outside. Important stuff that we need to look at is in here, inside the testis. So if we're looking inside testis, kita pergi sebelah sini. Inside the testis, you will find that it is consisting of many tubes. Dalam testis, so ada banyak tube. All those tubes are called seminiferous tubules. And then inside the seminiferous tubules, it looks like this. Dia ada begitu, dia ada macam lapisan tisu di luar. And then lots of immature sperm. Lepas tu tengah-tengah dia kosong. So it will be like this with immature sperm inside. And then tengah-tengah adalah kosong. What we need to focus on now is this segment of the seminiferous tubules. Okay, so if we took that segment, if we take this segment, kita kasih besar, kita tengok di sini, dia akan nampak macam ni. Akan ada basement membrane. There will be this is a reference photo for me while I draw. There will be spermatogonium. And then you would have primary spermatocyte. Secondary spermatocyte. And last but not least, spermatids. Spermatid ini adalah yang belum cukup matang. Okay. Yang sudah cukup matang, nama dia spermatozoa. Dan dia makin di luar. Okay, spermatozoa. Yes. So I'm showing you what is inside a cross section of the seminiferous tubules. while also recalling the cells that you can find inside. Okay, and there's one more cell here that you would have seen before. I'm going to give it a different color. Okay. Dia akan nampak macam ni. This is its nucleus. And this is its cytoplasm. Okay, and then this is the neighboring cell of the same type. Okay, so I'm gonna color this in the little pink. Okay, sambil saya lukis nih, saya harap kamu sambil pikir lah ini adalah sel apa. So does anybody want to have a guess what cell is this pink thing that I just drew on the screen? Anyone? Yes. Betul, Akil. So this one is a Sertoli cell. Yang pink ini, yang bentuk dia pelik, cytoplasm dia tidak bentuk dia macam pelik-pelik. This one is Sertoli cell. And then each of these cells, like I mentioned their names as I was going through them. I'm just going to label them as we go. This one is your spermatogonia. Or spermatogonium, kalau satu. This one is primary spermatocyte, secondary spermatocyte, spermatid. Dan yang sudah cukup matang itu adalah spermatozoa. Okay, so that is very quickly the whole male reproductive system. Any questions so far? Mungkin kamu kurang paham kah apa itu spermatogonium, kamu kurang paham apa yang berlaku. You can text, you can ask question, ataupun kita teruskan. Okay, kan? We can continue. Yes, all right. Lovely. Then I need to tell you, oh, I need to ask one person to tell me the anatomy of a spermatozoa. Kalau kamu diminta untuk label spermatozoa, apa yang kamu perlu label? Nicholas, can you name the four parts of a spermatozoa, a sperm cell? Dia ada kepala, dia ada something else. Okay. Alright, Lim sudah jawab dalam chat. Head, neck, middle piece, and tail. Correct. So this part is the head. Yang tengah-tengah ini adalah neck. Yang ini adalah middle piece. Dan yang panjang ini adalah tail. Okay, I need somebody to tell me. What organelle is in what organelle is inside the middle piece? And why do you find that organelle there?
Mitochondria.
Yes, correct. It is the mitochondria. And why do you need mitochondria in the middle piece?
To provide energy.
Yes, correct. So inside the middle piece, there is lots and lots of mitochondria to provide energy for movement. Sebab sperm ini dia perlu berenang. Yep, correct. To provide energy for movement. Okay, so that should be very simple. Bila kita cakap pasal sperm, we also talk about spermatogenesis, yaitu proses penghasilan sperm. Okay, spermatogenesis is actually quite simple before we look at the hormone-hormone. Dia akan start dengan spermatogonium. Lepas tu dari spermatogonium dia akan mitosis menjadi primary spermatocyte. Okay, ini saya, because I'm using my finger instead of the pen, so I write very slow. That is a lagi short form. After primary spermatocyte, it will undergo meiosis 1. Meiosis 1 to become secondary spermatocyte. Primary spermatocyte undergo meiosis 1, jadi secondary spermatocyte. Secondary spermatocyte undergo meiosis 2 to become spermatid, which is immature sperm. Daripada spermatid, untuk menjadi spermatozoa, ini adalah satu proses yang digelar sebagai spermiogenesis. Proses di mana spermatid matang dan menjadi spermatozoa. So if you need to remember the steps in spermatogenesis, this is it. Okay, ada masalah? Okay. If there are no questions, I am going to move on to the next bit where we are going to talk about hormones. So let us talk about hormones. Tell me the four hormones that are involved in spermatogenesis. Anybody?
GnRH.
Yes, good. GnRH. Anything else? LH.
LH. FSH.
Mm-hmm.
Testosterone.
Okay, very good. Testosterone. All right. Very good. So that one just now was Uzair Khan. Thank you very much. So we have several hormones here. You have GnRH, which will be produced in what gland? Dihasilkan di mana? Hypothalamus, correct, Leah? Okay, so you have your brain, otak kamu. Satu bahagian otak kamu itu digelar sebagai hypothalamus. So yeah, my laptop is trying to reconnect. Are your line okay? Alright. Ya, sambung balik sudah. Sorry ya. It's okay. Sorry, itu stuck tadi. Alright, I'm back now. I hope you guys are doing okay. Alright, so apa yang dicakap tadi? Saya cakap tadi, ini adalah hypothalamus. Hypothalamus hasilkan GnRH. Dan yang orang pertama yang akan menerima GnRH adalah pituitary gland. Pituitary gland ini adalah satu kelenjar di dalam kepala kamu, namun di bawah otak. Dia ada bahagian depan, ada bahagian belakang. So, kelenjar, bahagian depan kelenjar ini dipanggil anterior pituitary gland. Bahagian belakang dipanggil posterior. In today's class, you are learning about the anterior pituitary gland. Yes, it does look like something that is hanging. Okay, so that is the anterior pituitary gland. Bila GnRH sampai kepada anterior pituitary gland, hormon apa yang akan dihasilkan oleh anterior pituitary gland? Anyone? What will the anterior pituitary gland produce? FSH and LH, right? FSH saya kasih hijau lah. FSH dengan LH saya mau merah. LH. So we've got FSH and LH coming out of the anterior pituitary gland. So these will go into the bloodstream. Dia akan ikut saluran darah. Ikut saluran darah, darah, darah. Of course, blood is going to travel all over the body, including to the testis. Okay, sampai ke bawah. Sampai ke bawah. Yang akan dipengaruhi oleh FSH adalah Sertoli cells. So FSH would come and simulate the Sertoli cells. Dia pergi masuk ke dalam testis. Dalam testis, FSH will simulate Sertoli cells. FSH. Bila Sertoli cell dirangsang oleh FSH, dia akan pastikan spermatogenesis berlangsung. Okay, whereas LH will go somewhere else first. LH akan pergi di Leydig cells. So Leydig cells, there are some cells that are right outside of the seminiferous tubules. Mana saya boleh lukis? You think of Leydig cells as cells that are right out here. Right outside of the seminiferous tubules. Leydig, mana satu sajalah yang kamu boleh ingat? Okay, so this one. LH akan pergi kacau dia. Okay, when LH gets to the Leydig cells will start producing testosterone. Ini yang akan hasilkan testosterone. I'm gonna use. Sana. Testosterone. The testosterone akan pergi merata-rata. Ada sebarang soalan berkenaan dengan hormon-hormon dalam lelaki? Oh ya, yeah. Testosterone will stimulate spermatogenesis. If no questions, we're gonna go into the tutorial question, boleh? Okay, I'm gonna go into the tutorial question then. Okay, so we are going to look at the tutorial question. Okay, ini adalah soalan tutorial chapter 9, dokumen yang sama dengan minggu lepas. Cuma minggu lepas kita buat bahagian plan saja, hari ini kita akan masuk bahagian essay. With the aid of diagram, explain the negative feedback mechanism in spermatogenesis. Jadi, diagram yang kita akan gunakan adalah, kalau kamu tengok dalam kamu punya lecture note, kita gunakan diagram ini. So, I'm gonna copy that diagram. Just like how you would copy this if you are writing this, answering this question. We start with hypothalamus, anterior pituitary, I will draw that it's going to produce GnRH, anterior pituitary, here it will produce FSH, LH. FSH is gonna affect Sertoli cells. LH is gonna affect Leydig cell. Sertoli cell is gonna produce, no, not gonna produce, is gonna cause spermatogenesis. And also at the same time, it will produce another hormone called inhibin. Leydig cell produces testosterone. My finger is not as good as my pen. Okay, testosterone also stimulates spermatogenesis. And yang lebih penting yang kamu perlu ingat adalah testosterone, it will play a part in negative feedback back to the hypothalamus and the anterior pituitary gland. Apa maksud negative feedback? Negative feedback means it's going to reduce something that caused it. So, contoh, testosterone, semakin banyak testosterone dalam badan, dia akan menyebabkan hypothalamus menghasilkan lebih sedikit GnRH. More testosterone will cause less GnRH to be produced by hypothalamus. At the same time, it is also inhibiting anterior pituitary from secreting more FSH and LH. Testosterone semakin banyak, GnRH semakin sedikit, FSH dengan LH semakin sedikit. Inhibin, the other hormone produced here, is also going to play a part in negative feedback mechanism by inhibiting anterior pituitary gland from producing more FSH and LH. Oops.
Miss.
Yes.
About the for in the diagram, right? For the test theorem, do we need to must draw the arrow to spermatogenesis from test theorem? If I draw from Leydig cell, can or not?
From Leydig cell, can, but then you add the word testosterone. So so alam tadi itu, can you just draw arrow straight away? What color do I want to use? Say I use green lah kan. If you want to draw arrow macam begini, you can. Just that at this arrow, you write testosterone.
Oh, meaning that must have testosterone.
Yeah.
Oh,
besides, it's
okay,
the
okay.
hormone that you associate with males, kan? If we're talking about what is a lelaki punya hormone, the first thing you're gonna think of is not GnRH, it's not Leydig cell, you're gonna think of testosterone. So that is quite an important keyword.
Okay, thank you, Miss.
Okay, welcome. Okay. Alright, so mark ini diagram yang kamu boleh lukis, tapi diagram ini cuma dua markah. So this entire thing, this very nice diagram, if you draw it like this, it's only two marks. I don't know why the tutorial question is like that, tapi dia bagi dua markah still di sini. So where is the rest of the marks? That's what we're gonna do now. We are gonna do some typing. Okay. So I'm gonna see what is the recommended one here. If I'm just reading the marks here, first you need to say that reproductive hormones are regulated by negative feedback mechanism. And then you need to explain that as the testosterone levels rise, it is going to cause the hypothalamus to be inhibited and decrease secretion of GnRH. After that, you say that anterior pituitary receive less GnRH and will produce even less FSH and LH. Testosterone will also directly inhibit anterior pituitary gland. So lebih kurang macam apa yang saya cakap tadi masa saya lukis. Okay, testosterone inhibit anterior pituitary gland. Therefore, even less FSH and LH produced. And then FSH at the same time simulates Sertoli cell. Sertoli cell will secrete inhibin. Inhibin will go to anterior pituitary gland and inhibit FSH secretion. Kenapa ada ini negative feedback mechanism? Kalau ada banyak testosterone dan banyak inhibin, that means the Sertoli cell and the Leydig cell is telling the brain, okay, kami sudah dapat hormon yang kamu hantar, kami sedang buat sperm, tolong jangan hantar banyak hormon lagi. Let us slow down so we can finish making this sperm first before you tell us to make the next batch of sperm. Lebih kurang begitu is what is happening. Okay, so for this one, later I will type it nicely and I can send it to you as an answer scheme. Yang bahagian teks yang banyak markah tu. The text itself is 6 marks. Ada soalan tak? Kak, okay sudah kamu. Okay, then in that case, any questions about the male reproductive system in general? If not, we go on to the ladies. move on to the ladies.
Boleh, Miss.
Okay, thank you. Sorry, ya. Petang-petang ni sedang mengantuk. So, thank you for sticking with me so far. Especially with the technical problems. Okay, then now we shall go on to the female reproductive system. Do you need a break before we continue? The line. Is my voice clear ka? Kamu boleh ikut saya? So, continue saya. Right, sorry for the difficulties. But we do need to have at least one live lesson a week lah. Okay, so we're gonna start with the start. We're gonna continue with the female reproductive system. And once again, I'm gonna draw the person. We start with the head. And then you have the body. Batak juga deh nih. Smaller head. And then body. Okay. Kelvis gitu deh nih. And then down here, we are going to look at the female reproductive system. Female reproductive system, you would start with the vagina. Okay. After the vagina is the cervix. And then you have the uterus. Okay, my uterus can be nicer than this. Hold on, let me make a nicer uterus. Okay, this is the uterus. Lepas tu dia ada begini, dia macam ada tangan. This is your fallopian tube. Ada dua fallopian tube. And over here, outside, you have your ovary. Dia macam tergantung di luar. Okay, so when you are reading the text, I'm going to label it as I go. Vagina. Yes, vagina. This is cervix. If you hear anything about cervical cancer, that happens here. This is the uterus. Fallopian tube. And then this is your ovaries. Kalau kita cakap pasal where is the endometrium, adakan kamu dah nampak perkataan endometrium dalam teks kamu? Endometrium is the lining of the uterus. So dinding uterus itu kita panggil sebagai endometrium. So far, okay?
Okay, Miss.
Macam okay, eh? Alright, so I'm gonna go into the ovary now. So I'm really just zooming into the pictures that you've seen in the notes. We're looking at the ovary. Inside the ovary, dia macam begini. Okay. And over here, just gonna pull up a reference picture for me to follow. Okay, dalam ni ada saluran darah. Of course, ada saluran darah sini. And then you would have primary follicles, primordial follicles, and then primary follicles, followed by oocytes. Secondary follicles and something that is mature. They always have the follicles surrounding them. Biasa ada satu lapisan sel yang menyelubunginya. Lapisan ini yang kita panggil sebagai follicle. Okay, and then sometimes they mature, not sometimes, once a month they mature, and it can come out of here. So dalam diagram ini dan kalau kamu bedah orang punya ovary pun mengkali nampak macam begini jugalah. You will see the cycle of oogenesis taking place in the ovary in kind of this direction. Yang paling tidak matang akan berada di sebelah sini. Yang paling matang akan berada di hujung di sini. Dan di bahagian bawah sini adalah lapisan sel yang pink ini, yang follicle. Bila dia sudah tiada itu oocyte dalam dia, dia akan jadi corpus luteum. Dan semakin lama corpus luteum itu semakin dia macam sampai penghujung hayat dia sudah, dia akan jadi corpus albicans. Penghujung sini. Okay, so most important thing for me to label is corpus luteum. This is secondary oocyte. This is Graafian follicle. Ataupun boleh dikatakan mature follicle. Secondary follicle. Primary follicle. Setakat ini okay kah? With ovaries and the things that you can find in the ovary.
Okay, Miss.
Okay, all right. Okay, then what else I need to tell you? Oogenesis overview. All right, so I already mentioned what does a secondary oocyte look like under the microscope. Ada saya cakap dalam lecture note. So I don't think I need to explain much about that. But if you have question, feel free to ask. Next, I would like to talk about oogenesis. I don't know what is like the proper pronunciation for it, oogenesis or genesis, but I'm just gonna say oogenesis. Okay, so when we talk about oogenesis, we start with oogonium. After oogonium, it's gonna go and mature. It's gonna become primary oocyte. This one, masih 2N. After primary oocyte, it undergoes meiosis 1. To form two possible cells, the first is it can become a secondary oocyte. The second possibility is it becomes a polar body. Polar body ada nucleus, ada cytoplasm, tapi dia sangat kecil dan biasanya polar body ini dia akan mati lah after some time. So this one is called the first polar body. It is produced after the first meiosis. Kadang-kadang kalau dia tidak terus mati, dia pun mungkin meiosis 2. Tapi kalau dia meiosis 2, dia akan jadi polar body juga. Dia tidak akan jadi cell line. So it's just gonna stay small and not very useful. But what about the secondary oocyte? The secondary oocyte will undergo meiosis 2. Undergo meiosis 2 to produce ovum. Produce one ovum and second polar body. Now, I mentioned this in the video and you can read it in the notes as well, but oogenesis is not a continuous process. Dia bukan start sahaja di sini, terus continue sampailah dia jadi ovum. It is going to take several breaks. So, who knows how many stages is oogenesis divided into? Kita boleh bagikan oogenesis ni kepada tiga fasa. Anybody knows? Ataupun dia bukan cakap tiga fasa lah. It's more like bila dia stop dan bila dia sambung. Multiplication, growth, and maturation. Multiplication, not quite. Growth and maturation. Mana kamu dapat jawapan kamu, Rahma? Macam saya tidak ingat mana saya dapat. Macam bukan dengan sumber yang saya ingat. Or maybe my question is not as clear as I thought it was. It's when in a girl or a woman's life will she have meiosis 1? When in her life will she have meiosis 2? Okay, maybe I wasn't clear. Or maybe my question made it more confusing. Okay, it's gonna be divided like this. Yeah, this is first stage, and then second stage. Second stage dikira begini, dan third stage dikira. I can divide oogenesis into these three stages or these three phases. Anybody knows when does the first part begin? When does this part happen?
Mitosis, Kamis.
Bukan mitosis. I'm talking about how oogenesis is not a continuous process. There's going to be a part that is before the baby is born. After the baby is born, it's not going to do anything. And then puberty. And then ovulation. Ovulation and completion of meiosis II. Okay. Oh, okay. Jawaban Andriana dengan Elod hampir-hampir. All right. So Andriana answered before birth, Kamis. Yes. So this first part, this one in the blue box, this one will happen before birth. So masa dalam kandungan lagi, when you're still a fetus, if you're a woman, when you're still a baby in your mother's tummy, you are already producing your oogonium, your primary oocytes. And then before you are born, all your primary oocytes will start meiosis I, but then it will stop at metaphase I. Ya, sampai di sini, sebelum kamu lahir, dia akan berhenti di metaphase I. Selepas kamu lahir, nothing really happens until you reach puberty. So, bila perempuan akil balik, especially with the first period, your first menstrual cycle, that is when only one of your primary oocytes will finish meiosis I, become secondary oocyte, and then stop at meiosis II. So before birth, this is during puberty, and monthly cycle. Dia akan habiskan meiosis I, teruskan kepada meiosis II, lepas tu dia akan berhenti di metaphase II, kalau tidak silap. Okay, yeah, it stops at metaphase II. And like Elod says, it's before puberty, after puberty, and during fertilization. It will only complete meiosis II if there is fertilization. We will touch on this again in 9.3, where exactly does the secondary oocyte finish meiosis II to become ovum and first polar body. Tapi basically, yeah, dia mesti ada fertilization baru dia lengkap jadi ovum. Unless there is fertilization, your cells will forever be secondary oocytes saja. Doing okay? Any questions? Alright, so I don't think there are any questions ataupun kamu pun macam mau habiskan. That's alright then. We're just gonna continue. Okay, we're just gonna go through the hormones that are involved. Hormones that are involved, of course, we are using GnRH juga because this lady also has a brain. Some people don't know that women have brains, but women have brains. Dia ada hypothalamus, dan hypothalamus dia di bawah hypothalamus ada anterior and posterior pituitary gland. And the hypothalamus produces GnRH. The woman's anterior pituitary gland also produces FSH and LH. And these two hormones will go throughout the body, through the bloodstream, and eventually it will reach the ovaries. the names of it makes a bit more sense because FSH stands for follicle stimulating hormone. So the follicle stimulating hormone will go and stimulate this thing, the pink parts, which is the follicles. Itu oocyte di dalam follicle. FSH will go and stimulate the follicle itself. And then the follicle will be producing estrogen. Follicle produce estrogen. Bukan sahaja follicle, corpus luteum juga boleh secrete estrogen. Okay, and then the luteinizing hormone, LH, will affect the whole area. It will affect. Luteinizing hormone akan memberi kesan di sini. Luteinizing hormone will affect the Graafian follicle, causing it to go into ovulation. And after that, luteinizing hormone will cause the ruptured Graafian follicle to become corpus luteum. Means follicle yang sudah pecah di sini nih. Folikel yang pecah di sini nih, dia akan berubah menjadi corpus luteum disebabkan oleh LH. And then there's one more hormone that is here, which is progesterone. Progesterone will be secreted by this corpus luteum. So corpus luteum keluarkan estrogen dan juga progesterone. Okay, any questions regarding this so far? Okay, boleh ikut?
Boleh, Miss.
All right, so begini sajalah, this is how you see where it is affecting it and where the cells are going, where the hormones are going. For the explanation itself, I would just use this diagram, this chart. So, carta ini memang yang kita akan guna banyak kali lah, dan mana-mana buku yang kamu rujuk pun biasanya dia akan tunjukkan carta yang sama. So, this is explaining how the different rising and falling levels of hormone affects what happens in the ovary and what happens in the uterus. Bila hormon itu sedikit, apa yang berlaku dalam ovary? Bila hormon itu banyak, apa yang berlaku dalam ovary? Apa yang berlaku dalam uterus? I would recommend that you look at this stage by stage. Okay, dan biasa kalau kita tengok carta ini, kita akan mula dengan first day of menstrual flow phase. Ramai yang mungkin beranggapan bahawa bila kita period itu adalah end of the cycle, itu yang penghujungnya. We should start before the period. No, we start at the period. So the first day when you started bleeding, that is the first day of the menstrual flow phase. First day of the menstrual cycle. And also you can consider that the first day of the ovarian cycle. Okay. Kalau saya explain dari awal sampai akhir, lebih kurang macam saya baca balik apa yang saya cakap dalam video kan. So, I'm just gonna highlight which areas you need to macam tengok balik. Okay. So, you should look at this when the LH reaches a very, very high level when it has that LH spike. This is what you should pay attention to. You should pay attention to the fact that it causes ovulation. Okay, bila level LH meningkat macam ni, memancak peaks, spikes, bila dia tinggi begitu, menyebabkan ovulation. After ovulation, LH jatuh, FSH jatuh. What is another event that you should pay attention to? You look at who is producing estrogen. As I mentioned in the video, estradiol adalah nama lain untuk estrogen. Okay, look at who is producing estrogen. When does it go up? What happens when it goes up? And why does it go down again? Okay. First part, tengok ini, 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 ini. Yang merah. Second part you should pay attention to is what I am going to color in light green. This second part is because of corpus luteal. Luteal phase. It's going to cause this thing. It's going to cause a surge in progesterone and also estrogen. And that causes something to happen here. And then you need to look at why it starts to fall. Why does it start to fall? For why does it start to fall, I use a different color lah, okay? Why does it start to fall? We use this purple one. Why does it start to fall? Why does it start to fall? And why does it start to fall? So these are the things that you should pay attention to. Bila kamu mau tengok balik chart tadi, kalau kamu masih kurang paham, you look at the red, red, red dulu, baru you look at the green, baru you look at the purple. I can send you a copy of this diagram yang saya sudah conteng nanti, so don't worry, you can look at this later and ask me questions. So far, do you have any questions regarding the female reproductive cycles, termasuk ovarian, termasuk menstrual? Miss, Miss share the drawings later kah? Yes, yes, I will share it later, Shima. Video pun saya akan upload di YouTube nanti. Tidak soalan? Okay, then in that case, we are gonna look at the essay question. Okay, so for the structure question, kan? Structure question, you can try to do question number two. Tapi kalau kamu sudah cuba menjawab, kamu akan perasan question number two ni ada part yang overlap dengan 9.3. So the parts that overlap with 9.3 is this one that I color in gray, and this question D. 2D. Tapi A, B, C, kamu boleh buat. I'm gonna focus on the essay question. That one nanti pelan-pelan lah. We can discuss that the next one. We are going to look at this question. Describe the phases in the ovarian cycle. So I know for your exam this semester, you may not have essay or structure questions. But it's still good to do this to help you digest the information and also exercise your brain a little bit. Okay, so for this one, dia akan tanya phases in the ovarian cycle. So let me just find your lecture note for ovarian cycle. So kalau lecture note kamu untuk ovarian cycle, ini tiga fasa dia. Ada follicular, ovulation, and luteal phase. So when you want to do the essay, essay mesti dalam bentuk renggan lah ya. Jangan buat poin-poin. Kalau poin-poin pun buat ayat lengkap. This is to prepare you for next semester. I hope next semester you have essay. Buat dalam perenggan. Start dulu cakap dengan you say that ovarian cycle consists of three phases. And then those three phases are follicular phase, ovulation phase, and luteal phase. And then you go and elaborate each of those answers, each of those phases. Baru kamu explain dalam fasa follicular phase ada apa. So you give like three or more points. Okay, these are the points that you can use to describe the follicular phase. Follicular phase daripada growing follicle sampailah ovulation. Second phase ovulation, you give satu ayat pun cukup sudah. Most important thing about ovulation is that high level of LH causes graafian follicle to rupture. Secondary oocyte release. Benda itu matang, benda itu pecah, benda itu keluar. Most important thing about ovulation. For luteal phase, you need to talk about LH transform ruptured follicle into corpus luteum. And then you need to talk about how corpus luteum will secrete estrogen and progesterone. Estrogen and progesterone semakin meningkat, okay, inhibits hypothalamus anterior pituitary, reduce secretion of LH and FSH. After this, you can talk about how the corpus luteum can degenerate because very, very low level of LH is now present. Itu saja. Okay, sorry for the technical difficulty. Kalau tidak, saya memang tulis di sini, tapi akan lebih lambat kalau saya tidak guna pen atau menaik. So later, I'll just get you the written version of these answers and I will send it to you in the group. Okay. Lebih kurang itu saja. Okay, I hope that was clear enough and not a total waste of your time. Before I kind of conclude the lesson, do you have any more questions regarding the female reproductive system or the hormone cycles?
Miss, may I ask you something?
Yeah.
So my sister was once diagnosed with a tumor in one of her ovaries. So this causes mm-hmm. that the ovary has to need to be removed. So my question is, does my mm-hmm. sister still have a chance of getting pregnant?
Well, that would depend on her other ovaries. Were both removed or only one? If both were removed, unfortunately, there is no chance for her to get pregnant naturally. Kalau kita cakap yang macam tidak natural, but I don't know how this applies in terms of like Islamic teaching lah. If we are talking about using surrogate eggs, contohnya kalau kita ambil oocyte daripada orang lain untuk dimasukkan dalam rahim wanita yang tersebut, then it's possible for her to get pregnant that way if she doesn't have both of her ovaries. If she still has one of her ovaries left, it depends on the health of that ovary. Ya, bergantung ovary itu sihatkah? Does it have any other health issues? If it's healthy, if it can still produce ovum, then no problem. She can still have her own children the natural way. Does that answer your question?
Okay, thank you, Miss.
Okay, tapi itu lebih bagus kamu refer kepada Dr. Puan lah, because they would have the technology to screen for those health issue. Kalau apa yang perlu bedah kah, atau yang perlu detect kah, Dr. Puan lebih tahu. I think in Malaysia macam it's still okay, because I feel like most of the health problems that you have in Malaysia, if you ask the doctor to check, dia orang boleh tolong check lah. But in other parts of the world, usually when women go and talk about their health issues, a lot of them feel that the doctors undermine what is their health condition. Especially kalau kita dengar pasal orang-orang di US kan, they complain that they have this health problem, they have this problem with their period tidak regular. But the doctor just say, ah, itu kamu anxiety saja tu, kamu stress saja tu, kamu risau saja tu, dan tidak bagi diagnosis yang sepatutnya. I'm not saying this happens only in the US, that Malaysia tidak begitu, but like, if this happens to you, or your family member, or someone close to you, it is not wrong to push for a correct diagnosis. Okay, kalau kamu ada masalah kesehatan macam ni, tidak salah untuk kamu memperjuangkan hak kamu untuk didiagnose betul-betul. Okay, terlari topik pula. Okay, any other questions? While I do some drawing, any other questions? No more questions? Okay kah? Kah, kamu tengok saya melukis ni. I did say I will draw this, so I'm drawing it. Okay, just to quickly summarize, in this video, we had a grand overview of the female reproductive system and also the male reproductive system. I'm going to share these diagrams with you after I figure out how to turn them into a smaller size, but still looks clear. And then I will send it to you in the group. Nanti saya buat itu Telegram channel, ketua kelas tolong buat grup WhatsApp dan add saya nanti. Once again, for those of you who are not aware, I am switching over to WhatsApp because Telegram is very, very bad. Telegram, dia bergantung kepada line. Kalau line kuat, baru message kamu masuk terus. Kalau line lambat, dia lambat juga dapat sampai kamu. Okay. That is it for 9.2. Kalau ada yang tak kita faham, tanya. Mulai esok, saya akan send kamu nota. Kalau video sempat siap, saya akan upload video dan nota untuk 9.3. 9.3, we talk about pregnancy, what happens inside the mother's womb when a baby is developing or a fetus is developing. We look at the terms for that later. And 9.4 is about the hormones that are involved in pregnancy. Saya macam mau kasih cepat sebab baru dapat tahu minggu ni, minggu depan kamu ada pra-PSPL. Do you still want to look at this exam? Or do I just stop sharing the screen? Okay, right, back to the topic. Pra PSPM next week. Pra PSPM kamu ikut format PSPM tahun ini, yaitu objektif. Soalan objektif ada 30. Dan dia adalah pemikiran aras, soalan aras tinggi lah. So it's more challenging than your UPS questions. We are going to do it on Thursday at 4 p.m. And it will be from chapter 1 to chapter 10, except chapter 6. Sebab chapter 6 kamu sudah buat untuk assignment. Macam kalau tidak silap, pra PSPM kamu akan buat dalam Google Form. Saya akan rilis juga lah bahan untuk chapter 10 minggu depan. Dan saya akan ajar sikit-sikit juga minggu depan. So hopefully enough for you to answer the one question for chapter 10. Chapter 10 tidaklah susah sangat, mudah sejak chapter yang agak susah dan mencabar chapter 2. Chapter 4. 7, 8, 9. So itu yang kamu perlu lebih tumpukan lah. And then your PSPM will be somewhere between 9 to 16 December. Okay, any questions? Yes, Sheila. Sheila is typing a question, I think. Okay, yang pembahagian markah adakah untuk setiap chapter? Pembahagian markah untuk setiap chapter, saya boleh bagi kamu yang lama punya. Yang baru punya masih sedang tunggu diorang send. But it's more or less the same lah. Yang satu chapter, berapa soalan begitu. I will send it later. Sorry ya, dari last week saya janji. Okay, thank you for reminding me. I'll try to do that today. I'm going to stop recording.